In this screencast, we will talk about feedforward control and its role in developing appropriate control schemes. So before we can really talk about where feedforward control can be used, we have to first focus on where feedback control fails, because a large majority of control processes are of a pure feedback-only control scheme. So therefore, in order to deviate from those schemes, there have to be reasons why. And there are a number of reasons why. Well, here we'll focus on three of them. The first is that perfect control cannot occur. A disturbance happens, but the controlled variable does not feel it. So in other words, a disturbance to the variable will happen, but the control process will already handle it. Because feedback control does not work until there is a deviation to the controlled variable, it is impossible for a disturbance to have no effect on this variable, which connects to number two. Because you are only measuring the controlled variable at the end of the process, there is no way to predict what's going to happen to this variable. An additional problem is that processes are slow or have large dead time can lead to control, which will take a while. Why? Because if a system has a very large dead time, let's say, for example, the disturbance will occur, the process won't feel it for a while, but once it feels it, it's going to take a while to actually act on it because of the slowness of the process. So feedforward control is a way to handle all three of these drawbacks. So to try to represent this, we're going to look at a somewhat rudimentary example of a blending tank. And in our blending tank, we are trying to control the output concentration, and we have two streams. So therefore, an example of a feedback-only scheme would be one where we would try to directly control the composition coming out via the flow rate of the first one. However, one example here would be, let's say that the flow rate of the first scheme is known to fluctuate a bit. So therefore, if that is a potential disturbance, our process won't recognize that disturbance, and therefore, if we see a change in this flow rate, that will then cause a change in the composition, which isn't necessarily good for when we're trying to control this outlet composition. So what we can do is develop a control scheme where we combine this feedback control with a feed-forward controller, which would be able to better control this process. Why? Well, the reason why is that if I see a change in the flow, what I can do is have this feed-forward controller send a direct signal to the valve saying that a change is going to happen. Therefore, the flow rate of the manipulated stream can be adjusted in advance notice of the fact that this flow is going to be changing. So now what we need to do is discuss some of the things about feed-forward control. So the first is that the variable or variables being used for feed-forward control must actually vary to some degree. Because if they're not fluctuating at all, there'll be no point to have a controller for it. And if they're only fluctuating in a small amount, it might not be worth it to introduce additional equipment and whatnot, which would introduce costs and also potentials for equipment for breaking and whatnot. So therefore, you want to make sure that these variables actually can vary in some way. The second part of interest here is that a model must exist that can relate the feed-forward variable or variables to the controlled variable. So the beauty of what feed-forward control does is if I know the fact that by changing my flow rate by 1 gallon per minute of this stream will cause my composition to go down by 0.02, let's say, mole fraction, what I can do is I know how to adjust the other stream, the second stream where the valve is, the manipulated variable, in order to adjust for that change. So therefore, you must be able to have a model with some reasonable accuracy. Otherwise, if you don't know how the variables are related, you're really not going to gain anything from this. So therefore, having a model is important. The third, obviously, is that the variable or variables of interest must be measurable. Depending on the process, this may not be as easy as it sounds, particularly if you're in a process with high pressure, high temperature, highly corrosive materials, etc. It may not be as easy to measure these, but in order for feed-forward control to properly work, you need to actually measure these variables to see how much they're fluctuating from their assumed steady-state value. So this process here represents a feedback feed-forward controller because the part in blue is indicative of the feed-forward process, and whereas the part of the control scheme. Black represents the feedback process. With the feedforward control scheme, the variable of interest, the controlled variable, is not measured. So therefore, this feedforward controller here is conducting analysis without knowing whether or not the composition here is too high, too low, or exactly where it should be. So that's kind of an important aspect here. By putting these together, the question is, from a block diagram standpoint, what does this look like? And as a start, we'll start with the part in black, which is the feedback scheme. And really, the feedback scheme is no different than what we saw before, where we had the transmitter. We'd have a set point with an appropriate gain. It would then go to the controller, the valve, the process, which here is the tank, and then out would come the composition. So therefore, this part has been maintained by this process. However, the question to ask ourselves is, how does the feed-forward controller fit in? And the way we can gain some insight on this is kind of looking at the diagram. What we notice here is that right before the valve, instead of it receiving one controller signal, it now receives two, both summed together, and the other one is the feed-forward controller. The feed-forward controller gets a signal from the flow transmitter, which means that the flow transmitter has to take into account the measuring of the flow rate of that stream, which we'll call here F1. By adjusting F1, I am also adjusting the composition. So therefore, there is a second tank transfer function here that represents the relationship between F1, the disturbance variable, and the composition coming out of the tank. So therefore, we have another block which shows that relationship. So therefore, the composition here changes because of two things: the change in the flow rate of the first stream and the flow rate of the second stream, which is being manipulated by the valve. This relationship would come out through a material balance. Now that we have developed our feedback and feedforward control scheme in a block diagram, and therefore we can conduct a good amount of analysis or put this into Simulink to kind of see how the processes act together. So to leave this, we'll have a few parting shots here of, well, why not have just a feedforward only control scheme? And in general, feedforward only control schemes are not very beneficial by themselves. The major reason why is something that was noted earlier, is that there's no measurement of the controlled variable. So therefore, the feedforward controller is acting the same way regardless of whether or not your desired variable is way too high, a little too high, way too low, a little too low, or just right. And there's no way for the feedforward part to know. Therefore, feedforward often works very well with feedback because feedback is measuring that value and just making sure that your scheme is online with what you're expecting it to be. Another issue with feedforward only is that it is very model dependent. So if the model that you have is not very strong or is not a great fit to the process, then that means you're going to have some problems when it comes to actually handling the control of this process. Again, feedback control can handle that because it measures the actual value and does comparison. So therefore, if the model is slightly off, it can adjust the manipulated variable to counteract that. And a final point, feedforward is not needed if the disturbance is minimal or has minimal effect. You'll just be introducing more software, hardware to your process, which could be prone to break and could be more trouble than it's worth, particularly when you have a control scheme already present from a feedback standpoint. So in this screencast, we took a look at the basic idea of feedforward control, why a process may benefit from feedforward control, and what it looks like from a block diagram standpoint.